let's talk a little bit about the ergodic axiom. The idea that past is not prelude, or alternatively, that structure is not stable, seems to have very profound implications for the behavior of financial markets. I think what I would say is we assert a false precision, which then allows people to carry on with more leverage, or alternatively, smaller capital cushion against unforeseen circumstance. We have a much more fragile system based on a logic that you can assume structural stability and you can anchor things in a knowable future. That's quite at odds with the
Well, let me say, one of the most wonderful things Joan Robinson told me was in one sentence, time is a device that prevents everything from happening at once. Okay, there's one problem. You can't get a sample from the future today because time is this device. So what the efficient market theory says, take a sample from the past and do the analysis, and a sample from the past is the equivalent of a sample from the future. That's called in stochastic probability theory, that's called the ergodic axiom, okay, which says the same probability distribution that governed what happened in the past is going to be what happened in the future. If you believe that, I have a bridge over here that I'll be willing to sell to you. People like Paul Samuelson, for example, in an article in 1968, said that if you want to make economics a science, you have to impose the ergodic axiom. Otherwise, economics is just history. So he imposes, and the ergodic axiom, he got the term from statistical mechanics. And what it is my professional colleagues who believe in this thing want to make economics a rocket science like astronomy or physics or chemistry. And they therefore impose these things which they believe are true in the rocket sciences. And Robert Lucas, for example, has said that assumptions on economics are impossible, foolish, etc. But they allow you to have a soluble problem.
And a model that's illuminating.
Therefore, we're going to impose these, which is much better than the descriptive ideas that you say, well, people are going to change their minds and so on. How do you write that in mathematics, you see? You'd have to space in period three, they're going to change their minds. So this is why the ergodic axiom and the efficient market theory is so popular with the economists, because they make themselves, I forget the one economist who said, economists have the physics envy.
Well, there's a sense in which people emotionally would like to feel the comfort of believing that there's order. And it may be a false comfort, but people like to feel like there is someone that understands, or I can follow this method and take care of my financial future. And those who challenge it, like Hayek, Keynes, Frank Knight, yourself, you might be, or Soros, you might be entirely correct, but you don't provide emotional comfort.
Well, my answer, what I tell my students is financial fortune awaits anybody who can forecast the future of financial markets. So the first question you've got to ask yourself is these financial advisors, why are they bothering taking care of your money? Why don't they just take care of their money and make a fortune instead of working for a small commission on your money? And the answer is they know. Another example I give is if you see an ad for a mutual fund, at the bottom of the ad, the SEC requires them to say, past performance is no guarantee of future returns. Well, that is a non-ergodic statement, you see. So it's written into the law, in essence, of security markets, that we're in non-ergodic
system. But the temptation to believe in order, if somebody will sell you that snake oil, has got to be very strong, or it would not persist.
So we put our comfort and faith into these guys until they lose us money. And that's why Bernie Madoff, which was clearly fraudulent. I mean, most of the financial markets are not fraudulent. These people make mistakes. It's not because they were trying to cheat anybody and so on. But why did people believe Bernie Madoff?
Well, another example. Using these methods of stable ergodic distributions, We have spawned a tremendous industry within finance called the derivatives market.
That's exactly the point there, exactly. Alan Greenspan was in October 2008 was testifying in front of Congress after this financial collapse in the derivative market, and they asked him how come, because he's the maestro of financial markets, and he says, I really don't understand it, because I believe that the investment bankers would look out for their stockholders and so on. And suddenly the whole, and he says, we have mathematicians, we have physicists, we have computer experts, and we even gave Nobel Prizes to people telling us how financial markets should be priced. And the quote I like is, this whole intellectual edifice collapsed. Mm. And then when they asked him, well, why did it collapse? He says, well, there was something in the structure of the edifice. I don't exactly know what it is, but if I find out, I'll be able to change my mind. And now you have behavior economists who talk about herd behavior. And, yeah. But that's impossible in the orthodox economic thinking, or what we should call, given this sign back was, old economic thinking.
And the use of leverage also implies a certain confidence that you can see the future, because you...
Well, debt isn't bad. I mean, if you think about it, if given double entry bookkeeping, if some people in the society are savings, then in order to keep the economy going, other people must be spending more than they earn, and the only way to spend more is to run down your savings or borrow. So debt per se is not a bad thing. It's a question of whether you can service the debt or not that becomes the problem.
Whether we invested with the proceeds of debt issuance in things that are productive
or
over time.
Well, let's take consumer debt, where you're investing in a suit or something. That's not going to create it. If you're earning enough income, you can pay the debt.
Sure.
Object of the game is to make sure that debtors have enough income to meet their obligations. And particularly in a capitalist society, if you're at less than full employment, there must be a way of generating more income.